Ah, poi mi dai
l'indirizzo.
Vado a vedere.
Regenerative agriculture is not a method. Is a way of looking at things, is an approach. And then within this approach, there will be appropriate methods for a certain crop, for a certain soil, for a certain environment, for a certain climate. From this field to that field there, I will use a completely different method of cultivation of the same crop, but the approach is the same. Nature doesn't waste. The whole system that we are setting up here is based on biomimicking nature and trying to create natural productive systems. That's the vision, to study, to experiment, and to get as close as we can to nature's behavior and productiveness and efficiency with all these amazing ecological services that nature gives to the biosphere. Here there are two important elements, slope management and space management. Slopes are very difficult to manage because we can't go with machinery. And slopes are the most erodible parts of the farm. So we need to keep them fully covered with either tree canopy or pasture. So we need to manage them with the help of animals, which are sheep, which will keep a nice and dense turf, allowing us to cultivate and to manage the hazelnuts. In this particular case, we have planted them on an hexagon shape, where at every angle we have a tree, and in the middle of the hexagon, we have another tree. This is the structure that resembles what bees do on the comb, the beehives. What bees do in order to have the maximum amount of cells on the comb in their beehives. These are an essential element of the regenerative farm because they increase functional biodiversity of the farm. And probably for us it's more important in pollination, and it's just secondary, the production of honey and all the rest of the products.
So cosa sono le keyline?
Andiamo a chiedere.
Se sono le keyline?
Sì.
Sono quelle curve qua. Le curve del frutteto. Visto che il frutteto non è tutto in fila, ma è tutto storto, quelle lì si chiamano keyline.
Sì.
Dove la curva diventa panciosa?
Sì.
È la valle dove va tutta l'acqua. Sì. E allora noi cosa facciamo? Facciamo queste curve qua, che prendono l'acqua dalla valle dove si accumula e dove ce n'è tantissima, è sempre bagnato, fangoso, scivoloso, puzzoloso, e la portiamo verso il punto più secco, così che gli alberi che ricevono poca pioggia e poca acqua hanno un po' di acqua e quelli che ne ricevono troppa non ne hanno troppa. Capito? Here we are growing fennel and beetroot. If you look at pasture, if you look at natural forest, it's never wasted. We try to do the same with vegetables. And the soil, it has to be completely covered by the trees and the plant canopy in order to have this beautiful effect of protecting the soil, having a lot of roots pumping carbon in the soil, activating microbiology, and creating really a pasture of vegetables. And this is space efficiency. It's done again by transplanting the plants on a diamond shape pattern. And we can produce per square meter one to two-thirds more food than is produced by conventional farms. It means that our vegetable production enterprise, it can be a one-third or to two-thirds smaller than a conventional one.
Molto caldo, è molto caldo, Yule. È molto molto caldo, soffia.
E come?
Bellissimo.
There are two extremely important elements of the landscape and of the farm. The first is access. Access is often something which is misunderstood and undervalued. Every single path, it becomes the veins of the farm where the flow of energy passes through. And especially here is a great example. This was, till 2 years ago, it was just like a battlefield, canyons and water during even the smallest of the rains. It was just like reaping the soil.
With the cars, we were just trying to find the best way to drive at the main gate.
So what we did, we did this compromise of using concrete, but because this is gonna remain an access, but at the same time, we managed to harvest all the water, excess water that runs when it rains. Even the smallest of the rains, it goes to multiple ditches like this, and then is harvested under the ground via pipe, and then to water tanks. From this road, we managed to harvest around 1.5 million liters per year, just with natural rainwater. And the angle of the road, it allows the water to flow toward this stone wall. And behind the stone wall, there is a whole drainage system with drainage pipes. And then all the water is sucked in by the wall and collected.
You enter in the property and you see very high quality fodder for animals. I mean, in this case it's alfalfa. We cut it like six times this year. It grows very fast. A beautiful legume that on its own root has got a symbiosis with some bacteria that in exchange of the sugars that the plant produces via photosynthesis, it feeds these bacteria which are called zobium. And in exchange, they fix nitrogen from the atmosphere, which is very abundant, but the plant can't use it. These bacteria fix it from a gaseous to a solid form. And the plant can absorb nitrogen, which is one of the three most important nutrients for all plants.
A very important part of water management will be done also on this access, where we'll have permanent ditches that will slow down erosion and bring all the excess water into rock holes that will divert and send water toward the deeper horizons of the soil, reaching the water table. So it's like feeding the water table. Every single farm should be feeding water table with excess water that can't be harvested, that can't be collected in tanks or ponds or crops. Every single path has to have more functions and they can be productive. Here we planted kiwis, female kiwis on the right side and male kiwis on the left side, and then we'll have horizontal posts. We'll grow the kiwis on top of it. And because of all the trellis or the pergola system will go through the whole axis of the farm, we'll have this air flow moving through the farm, so we'll have cold spots that will allow us to create this vortex of air in the whole farm. And air is extremely important to control pathogens, especially fungi and bacteria. I'm completely in love with mulberries because they have a million functions. We planted 25 varieties of mulberries in the last 3 years, and this is possibly the most high in protein leaf in the whole farm. So it reaches 24% of protein and very high sugars and very high digestible matter for animals. So it makes mulberry possibly the best fodder we can have here for our animals. And then leaves are extremely nutritious for animals. It grows in the drought. It produces amazing fruits, very sweet, very high value for the market. And because we sell directly, we can harvest them and sell them straight away. Something that the supermarkets can't do because it just ripens so fast that it will rot in a few hours. So these will be planted in the whole farm in bushes that will be used for animals as a protein source and high energy. Again, a perennial crop rather than an annual crop used for animals. It's a perfect connection from what was successful in the past and what is successful now in the future. So it's not about saying no to technology, no to research, no to science, no to universities, but it requires a different way of looking at things.